Welcome to the NTN Nightly. I'm Nisha Charles. This edition's top stories. Scores of St. Lucians joined the government in paying respect to former government minister and educator Gaspard Charlemagne. A new tourism attraction has opened on the island's west coast. The celebration of the La Marguerite Festival is in full bloom. Scores of St. Lucians on Friday paid their respect to former government senator and junior minister in the Ministry of Education, Gaspard Charlemagne. The veteran educator died on October 1, 2019. Janelle Norville reports.
The late Gaspard Charlemagne served in many capacities, including chief education officer from 1998 to 2000 and junior minister in the Ministry of Education from 2006 to 2011. His daughter, Effia Charlemagne Norbert, described him as a man of servant leadership who was always willing to help someone in whatever way he could. He was also an organist in the Soufre Catholic Church for approximately 60 years. His passion, according to his daughter, had always been education.
He loved education. That was his big, that was his passion. And throughout his life, his career spanned from teacher to principal into the Ministry of Education and then, of course, into junior minister of education. He went into politics just a few years ago and saw it as a means of helping the community of Soufre. What I take from him, leadership, servant leadership, always helping somebody out, always being giving, always being a generous man.
Son-in-law Zephyrinus Churchill Norbert remembered Charlemagne as an agile statesman who embraced all aspects of life, including religion, family, and politics.
He was always prepared to serve at the highest level, and he loved his family dearly, his wife and, of course, his children, sisters, brothers, relatives. Mm-hmm. And, you know, one of the final words he'd have said to us was that, you know, at the place where he is now, he's seen beautiful things. So we know that he is at peace with the Lord, and that brings us tremendous comfort. So we just want to extend our sincere thanks to all supporters, family members, for the prayers and well wishes.
Former Prime Minister and longtime friend Mikey Pilgrim described Charlemagne as an educator and someone very involved in the development of the youth. Pilgrim added that Charlemagne believed that an educated people was necessary for the progress of St. Lucia and was committed to ensuring that progress.
Gaspard, as an educator, did well within the Ministry of Education, as a teacher, and as an education officer. Gaspard also felt at some point in his life he would like to become an elected member of the House of Assembly. Unfortunately, he never made it, but he was privileged to have become a senator and a minister at one stage. He served as a minister for at least 5 years, and during that time, he cooperated with the government and did a fairly good job. Today, I'm saddened by his death as a true friend, and I express my condolences to his family and friends. Gaspard, my friend, rest in peace.
Gaspard Charlemagne was also a government senator in the St. Lucia Senate. Minister for Physical Planning and Parliamentary Representative for Soufre, Honorable Herod Stanislas, said Charlemagne was a great counsel and provided him with immense support.
We had many interactions, especially during my campaign of 2016. He came, he gave me overwhelming support on the campaign trail. He was present at a couple of meetings that we had. We had private meetings as well, and I want to thank him immensely for that support. And I am just wishing the family the very best, God's richest blessings, and I'm certainly sure that they will gain strength in knowing that their father, their brother, their uncle served Soufre and St. Lucia with distinction.
The body of the late Gaspard Charlemagne laid in repose at the House of Assembly on Friday, 18th October 2019. For the Government Information Service, I am Janelle Norville.
There has been a voluntary recall of ranitidine, Zantac medicines from certain manufacturers. The Ministry of Health and Wellness wishes to alert the public about the recent recalls and also wishes to inform them of the situation locally. Alison Jean is the procurement officer within the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
The Ministry of Health and Wellness has been informed of the recent alerts by the United States Food and Drug Administration and the United Kingdom Medicines and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency for the voluntary recall of ranitidine capsules and tablets by Sandoz and Apotex and Zantac tablets, liquids, and injectable preparations from GlaxoSmithKline. Our investigations have revealed that these medications from the affected manufacturers are not available in the public sector pharmacies. That is, they are not available at Victoria Hospital, St. Jude Hospital, the District Medical Hospitals, and the wellness centers.
Ms. Jean provided an update on what obtains in the private sector.
In the private sector pharmacies, specific lots from the affected batches of Zantac tablets from GlaxoSmithKline were identified and have been removed from the shelves. The Ministry of Health and Wellness advises that persons who are unsure whether they have the product should consult their healthcare provider. For any further inquiries and information, please contact the Drug Inspector, Ms. Astrid Mondesi, at the Ministry of Health and Wellness at telephone number 468-5311.
And that was Procurement Officer in the Ministry of Health and Wellness, Alison Jean. A new tourism attraction has opened on the island's west coast. More from Anicia Antoine.
The Parliamentary Representative for Ancillary Canneries, Honourable Dominique Fede, opened the latest addition to St. Lucia's tourism product in Ancillary. The newly established Glittering Sands Beach Park, located at Trulager, is owned and operated by St. Lucians and employs some 20-plus persons from the constituency of Ancillary Canneries. The beach park welcomed the first group of over 50 cruise ship guests for a fantastic day in paradise. Honourable Dominique Fede expressed gratitude to the investors for having confidence in the project.
I am moved with emotion. And it's all part of what my government believes in sustainable development, creating jobs for people and ensuring that, you know, young people, old people have opportunities everywhere they go. And really to make use of this beautiful spot is just an incredible, incredible feat and an incredible opportunity for all of us, for the people that are working here, for the small businesses that are created. There's a local ancillary resident who has established a spa facility. There's a local resident from Marigot who has established a kayaking business. There's the Valles restaurant who have established the food and beverage outlet. So the economic impact is enormous.
The Glittering Sands Beach Park provides water sports, food and beverages, a souvenir shop, storage facilities, washrooms and an outdoor spa.
If you look at how the construction has been done, everything is environmentally friendly, using a lot of local woods from the area. You look at the cladding is done by the Roseau wood, for example, which is very familiar in the Roseau River, not too far from here. But what is being exposed is you've got a number of tours, the waterfall tours, the snorkeling, the kayaking. A little later on, I'm sure that they'll get into diving because some of the most beautiful reefs are in these parts. And so it is an enormous feat by all of us to be able to pull this off.
The Glittering Sands Beach Park was officially opened on Thursday, October 15th, 2019. From the Government Information Service, I am Anicia Antoine reporting.
St. Lucia's cultural policy was first drafted in 2005. And since then, efforts have been made to develop and strengthen the framework. The Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Tourism, Information and Broadcasting, Culture and Creative Industries, Donalyn Vite, is attending the fifth meeting of ACP Ministers of Culture, where she will have the opportunity to learn of the association's best practices. The aim, she says, is to cement policy decisions and better merge culture and tourism.
For us in St. Lucia, what we are focusing on right now is the development of our cultural policy that's actually dated back since 2005 in a way that we could encapsulate some of the new technologies, new ideas, and the development of our sector, not just the creatives, where persons probably feel that when they reach the stage, they have made it, but in a way that we can use the creatives and put them on the map That too will cause St. Lucia to be on the map and help our destination branding and marketing. The objective is not to water down our culture to meet tourism, but to keep the essence, the cultural values and our heritage core, and keep it pure in a way that we can still package it and release as part of our tourism product.
The meeting will also seek to assess the implementation of the commitments made by ACP ministers in Brussels in 2017 and to reach a strong ACP group position on culture's contribution to the achievements of the Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs. The permanent secretary believes that Caribbean people should have a greater voice within the ACP group.
With all of the funding that has been available and what is to come, that the Caribbean should have a stronger focus in terms of the equitable distribution of those funds. And so while we have been bypassed as maybe being the smaller contingent within the ACP countries, our voice has not been diminished. And so I think this forum provides an opportunity for the Caribbean to speak and then for the Caribbean to act.
The fifth meeting of ACP Ministers of Culture takes place from October 17 to 20, 2019, in Niger. And speaking of culture, the celebration of the La Marguerite Festival is in full bloom. Thursday, schools and community groups brought the tradition to life.
The Feast of La Marguerite, one of the two rival floral cultural festivals of St. Lucia, is celebrated annually on October 17th. This year, the festival, organized by the Cultural Development Foundation, consisted of an ecumenical service in Laclery and the Gwan Fete in Monrepo. All members of the La Marguerite Society dressed in the attire of their respective roles and marched to the Monrepo Catholic Church. The service was followed by a parade through the streets before returning to the Monrepo Combined School for their feasting. Senior Business Development and Marketing Officer with the Cultural Development Foundation, Jimmy Clavier, expressed contentment with the turnout at the festival.
The Flower Festival in particular, you have a loss when it comes to the musicians and the chanteuses and chanteuses. You have an increased interest from the general populace and the general public. We recognize that you will have that type of shift. And it is that shift that is encouraging us to now pull and encourage persons to more or less gravitate and ensure that the flower festivals do not just dissipate. It is an indigenous culture, and we want to ensure that it remains. If we do not actually buy into it, as was suggested in the church service, of course it's going to fade away. And that's what we're trying to avoid. For us right now, something which is indigenous to St. Lucia should be maintained, should be supported, and should be cultivated.
The Gwan Fete consisted of 8 groups in total. Antoninus Thomas, Marguerite King for Denry Group 1, has been participating in the festival for over 30 years.
Culture does not remain stagnant, it evolves. And the fact that, you know, those changes happen means that there's a certain vibrancy to what's happening. One of the things that is lamentable, however, is the decline in the number of groups that celebrate the festival. And I think that is the area where we can work on. We need to try and get more groups active in other communities so that our culture can be like propagated throughout the whole island. This is the only thing that is uniquely St. Lucian.
The La Marguerite Festival forms part of the calendar of activities for Creole Heritage Month. From the Government Information Service, I am Anicia Antoine reporting.
And this is the NTN Nightly. Ryan O'Brien is out on assignment, but when we return, St. Lucia's deepening friendship with the Republic of China, Taiwan.
I was in my neighborhood. It was a very dark night, and I decided to go for a drink by a bar. On my way from the bar, I felt the sting to my right leg. And when I looked back, I knew it was a footless snake.
You happen to be in an area where there are snakes and you are bitten by a snake. This is what you do. You call for help and try to reach the Victoria Hospital within 1 or 3 hours. You will be seen immediately.
My uncle at the time was a police officer, called Victoria Hospital and told them that we're coming down for snake bite.
It's the only facility on the island which has a protocol and a treatment plan where you can be treated adequately.
We call them before you go.
there so they can prepare for you.
And rest assured that there are adequate supplies of antivenom with doctors who have been trained in the treatment protocols of the snake bite.
Welcome back. The 2019 annual meetings of the Boards of Governors of the World Bank Group and the International Monetary Fund, the IMF, is currently taking place in Washington, D.C. until Sunday, October 20. The annual meetings bring together central bankers, ministers of finance and development, parliamentarians, private sector executives, representatives from civil society organizations, and academics to discuss issues of global concern, including the world economic outlook, poverty eradication, economic development, and aid effectiveness. Prime Minister and Minister for Finance, Economic Growth, Job Creation, External Affairs and the Public Service, Honorable Alan Chastney, and Minister for Economic Development, Honorable Guy Joseph, are currently attending the meetings, along with a team from the Department of Finance, which includes Permanent Secretary of Finance, Cointhia Thomas, Director of Research and Policy, Gemma Lafayette, and Department of Economics Development's Permanent Secretary, Claudius Emmanuel. In the Prime Minister's absence, Minister for Equity, Social Justice, Local Government and Empowerment, Honorable Leonard Montoute, serves as Acting Prime Minister. St. Lucia's deepening friendship with the Republic of China, Taiwan, has resulted in a shipment of humanitarian supplies. Chevron Marius has the details.
The Embassy of the Republic of China on Taiwan has once again demonstrated its nation's support by donating an assortment of humanitarian supplies to the government and people of St. Lucia. The handing over ceremony took place on Tuesday, October 15, 2019, at the car park of the National Emergency Management Organization, NEMO. Counselor and Taiwanese representative Bill Hung expressed his government's enthusiasm in assisting the poor and vulnerable of St. Lucia.
The Simply Health Foundation was formed in the year 2000 in the United States, and it is very active in 23 countries. And the foundation is dedicated to relieving poverty by providing emergency disaster relief, vocational training, and shelter and care for the homeless elderly. The foundation has cooperated with the government of Taiwan to contribute charity goods to the people of St. Lucia. Today, I'm more than happy to announce that this year, Simply Help is providing items including clothing, toys, shoes, baby supplies, and electronics, to name just a few, for those households in need.
The items included shoes, kitchenware, clothes, toys, baby supplies, suitcases, and stationery. Minister for Equity, Social Justice, Local Government and Empowerment, the Honorable Leonard Montoute, expressed his gratitude to the Taiwanese government for providing the much-needed supplies.
I want once again to place on record my government's appreciation for the donation, especially given the target population that it is intended for. I have every confidence, I have no doubt that as in previous years, those who are most in need and most deserving will once again receive those gifts. And I'm sure, as always, there will be much appreciation on their part. I just want to say as government, we look forward to that kind of continued collaboration. In particular, my ministry, as you are aware, is a social ministry, and our task is mammoth, our resources limited, and any form of collaboration that comes our way, we are happy to embrace.
The Simple Help Foundation has donated to the government and people of St. Lucia from 2015. Reporting from the Ministry of Equity, Social Justice, Local Government and Empowerment, I am Chevre Marius.
The Department of Infrastructure, Ports and Energy intends to undertake potholing roadworks along Bridge Street near the RC Boys Primary School, Marion Street, Rock Hall Bus Stand and along the Bagatelle Road. This activity is scheduled for Sunday, 20th October 2019, between the hours of 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. The Department of Infrastructure solicits your cooperation and advises that all road users should exercise due diligence in the immediate vicinity of the work site. And stay with the NTN Nightly. Up next, Primus Hutchinson is here with the NTN Nouvelle Aquaio.
If you are in receipt of an abnormally high bill,
it is highly possible that you have a leak. That leak may not always be visible. Before you contact WASCO, conduct a do-it-yourself test. 1. Record your meter reading. 2. Do not use water for 30 minutes to 1 hour. 3. Take another meter reading. If the reading changes, you have a leak. Contact a plumber to identify and fix the leak at the earliest. A message brought to you by the Water and Sewage Company Incorporated, WASCO.
Welcome back. We join Primus Hutchinson for the NTN Nouvelle Aquarium.
Messieurs, Mesdames, Département qui est responsable pour information au gouvernement CTLC, GIS, à ce moment-là, Télévision Nationale, PIA, NTN, qui est le Nouvelle Aquarium. Vous êtes Primus Hutchinson. Les résidents à Wet Powers Sud-Est Castry, qui semble en caille la paresse en baisson à 6h et demi, à 6h, lundi au soir, pour trouver information concernant les projets pour stabiliser Tiwas et Canal en ces paresses-là, qui a coûté plusieurs millions de dollars. Les consultants, les gens qui ont ces contrats-là, les officiers techniques du gouvernement, les ingénieurs du département des affaires et construction, qui ont une initiative là un effort pour continuer à engager tout le monde qui est intéressé à un projet là, pour savoir en qui degré préparation depuis un commencement pour finissement. Consultation qui a été ces participants à l'occasion pour discuter ces différents travaux là qui ni pour faire un degré résilience climat et pour même parler de tout ce qui a concerné eux. Département pour planer affaires économiques et puis division qui est responsable pour projet là. Ensemble, et puis département des affaires construction, car ouais engagement ça là, croyons qui est très important, comme il a fait possible pour ouais empêcher et aussi pour mettre divers changements en place, pour adresser situation de l'environnement et l'autre situation sociale qui peut menacer habilité projet ça là, pour dire consultation et puis les résidents, car aussi pour trouver l'occasion pour ménager attitude et espoir. Avant mis ce travail là. Qui a fait en façon de résilience climat, c'est Walmason et ça qui a ni aussi Payen Gabian pour Chebe Mason na plus fort. La gani fier glorisida planté bordage c'était wasla pour pêcher afalai c'est vrai de cela. C'est résident qui a aussi trouvé une décision à sa meilleure manière pour déposer son dieu pour faire assurer qui projet a pris la diwaye. C'est comme une qui a espéré ses bénéfices pour ça là, c'est Country Village, Otsa, Bas-de-Chaussée, Belay, Besson, Ravine Poisson, Mac, Crownlands, L'Abbaye, Gap Sarot et Derba. L'autre commune qui s'est posé trouver bénéfice pour ça à la même façon ça là, c'est Marchand, Miku North, Village d'Henry et Forestier. Grand projet ça là qui a coûté 6 millions de dollars. Pour stabiliser Tewas et Canal, qui a commencé tout de suite, afin d'avoir des semaines pour venir, et supposé durer pour 6 mois, pour que j'ai l'occasion d'employment pour plusieurs résidents dans ces communes-là. Celle-ci a continué à enregistrer succès en hôtel les touristes qui ont visité le pays-là. Selon l'autorité des affaires touristiques à celle-ci, pour 7 ou 8 mois, le pays a enregistré augmentation en l'immobilier les étrangers qui ont tué un pays là plus haut passé plus temps avant. Pour moi, à haut, cette liste enregistré 36 342 touristes qui visitaient pour vacances. Et ça, c'est plus haut en l'immobilier les touristes qui jamais visité le pays là pour moi. À haut. Pour la place de l'Amérique, 13% visitation. L'Angleterre, 12%. Et le Canada, 17%. Ça a marché une augmentation de 6,4% en total pour l'enregistration en mois à août l'année passée. Selon le ministre de la responsabilité des affaires touristiques, honorable Dominique Fédé, ça a montré ces programmes-là, les WEG et diverses activités que le ministère a déplimenté, déjà entré en faveur des pratiques en région et aussi à la place internationale. Le ministre Fédé a ajouté que, comme la saison Fédé a commencé, pays a qu'à continuer pour plus en plus bénéfice ces programmes ça là et la pas une pièce doute qui la place là qu'à profiter mais la place là qu'à profiter sa pièce d'autre. Si des places là, l'Amérique avec l'Angleterre qui a conduit, et puis 11% avec l'Amérique 9, sorti l'année passée pour l'année ici, date pour date. Pays Canada avec France, c'est seulement de la place là que j'ai réduit à sa place pour ces 8 mois à l'année passée. Pays Saint-Lucie, trouvez l'occasion pour expérimenter l'opération qui est avancée devant une conférence des associations les docteurs qui ont performé l'opération Sayoni pour flanger la chair mouna. Conférence, c'est docteur Salah, ensemble et puis association les professions docteurs à Saint-Lucie qui était prévu le 27 ou le 28 septembre. Ce docteur Salah performé l'opération Salah le 26 septembre à l'hôpital Saint-Jude pendant une session d'instruction de prévu en Hotel Bay Gardens en Rodney Bay. Conférence là, c'était pour comprendre manière si l'opération Salah qu'a fait présentement en Caraïbes et aussi en ces pays Dutch, français, espagnol et anglais. Durant cette session Salah, ce docteur Saint-Lucia un témoignage pour l'opération en façon de démonstration notre docteur Saint-Lucy même en rejoignant avec yo qui sorti en pays international. L'opération ça c'est un qui a fait côté ce docteur a quand il fait un petit flangeai à sous la peau et ça a apporté bon bénéfice pour ni docteur et ces patients là aussi. Conférence là c'était un succès selon l'association et plus que 40 participants sortis à 14 pays en parmi eux c'était Caraïbes même l'Amérique et Europe. Ce docteur a performé 5 opérations, 4 en yo qui partent jamais avec qui partent qui fait normalement en cette ici. Qualité c'est l'opération ça là très avancé en façon technologie et attention j'ai à son manière ça peut trouver performé en Caraïbes là. Et c'est comme ça nous avons une nouvelle là. On va mettre au temps pour garder. D'abord une invitation pour jeune puis moi encore si Dieu conserve la vie. Nga ipo sa tout nouvelle à Creole. Te mo souhaite tout moun a bon fin de semaine. Et ça c'est le mot vie pour sa tout.
Merci Opel Primus. And here's a look at what's happening to us weather-wise.
Generally cloudy skies with scattered showers and a chance of isolated thunderstorms. Moisture and instability in the wake of a tropical wave will continue to generate cloudiness, showers and a few thunderstorms across the Lesser Antilles. Another tropical wave located over the central tropical Atlantic is moving westward near 17 miles per hour or 28 kilometers per hour. Tides for Castries Harbor high at 5:55 p.m., low at 1:02 a.m. Tides for Beaufort Bay low at 12:54 p.m., high at 7:02 p.m. Seas slight to moderate with waves 3 to 5 feet or 0.9 to 1.5 meters. The sun will rise Saturday at 5:55 a.m.
And that brings us to the end of the NTN Nightly. Join us next time at 7 p.m. with a repeat at 7 a.m. You can also catch up with us anytime on the Saint Lucia Government Facebook page or YouTube channel. I'm Nisha Charles.